Hey guys, welcome back. In this video, we will continue the discussion about objects. And specifically, I would like to explore the area of working with more complex object hierarchies. So far, the objects that we have played with were rather simple. All the properties that we were putting into those objects were of primitive data types. However, the entire system of objects in Codeless and just in object-oriented programming in general allows to create more complex hierarchies. So what we will be doing in this lesson is we will create an object that contains additional objects in one of the properties referenced through an array, and there will be multiple new things that you will learn about. Some of them are intuitive, just because you already know how arrays and lists work, and some of them might be new. So the starting point is going to be the same Codeless logic that we had from one of the previous lessons. And in here, we create an object that represents a person, and that object is stored in the person variable. So since this object represents a person, let's say that that person has a collection of addresses where that person, let's say, has properties or addresses of the companies where that person worked. The semantics can be completely up to you. We'll probably come up with a collection of addresses where that person has, let's say, properties. So for this, let's create a list that will represent the properties that that person has, and every single item in that list will be a address object that contains, let's say, city and state. We could also add street address as well, just to make it more complete. And for this, let's create a variable that will be called addresses, and set this addresses property to a new list. So in the list category, you will find the create empty list. All right. Now, for this list, we need to populate it with some address objects. And for this, if we go into lists and define this block and change this to addresses, in here, the add block, where we add an element to this list, is going to be the create new object block, this one. And let's set up our properties. So let's say it's going to be street, street address, and then there's going to be city, and there's going to be state, just like that. And the values, let's populate it with values. So let's say it's 123 Main Street, and then the city will be Dallas, and the state is Texas, just like that. So as a result of this, a new object is added to our list. If we want to add another object, then we can replicate it like this, and this will be, how about 555 Commerce Avenue, New York City, and the state is New York. Okay, and as a result of this, there will be two objects in our list, and that will be fine. However, with a few iterations of running this page, we will actually modify this logic, where we will move some of the functionality to create a new address into a function. We'll be making it more interesting and maybe complex, maybe simpler, depending how you look at it. But the point right now is to create that list of objects, and we already have that list with two objects in there, and associate that list with our person object. So to associate it, we essentially need to set a property in the person object. And property setting is done using this block, set property in. And we will be setting the property in the person object, and the property will be addresses. Now, the reason I called it addresses is not because we have the variable called addresses. In fact, there is no correlation between the property name and the variable name. Okay. or as a and because of that, the actual property can be called whatever you want. We can call it my places, all right, and that will be fine. Addresses kind of closer to the nature of the, what this variable represents. So now what we have is we have the person object that has these three properties of the basic primitive data types. And then there is one property called addresses that contains a list of these objects. Let's take a look as to what that person object actually looks like by printing it out. And for this, I will put it in here and I'll just run this page. The page runs and let's take a look. So here's our person object. And as you can see, addresses is also expendable. And inside of addresses, we have two sub-objects that represent our addresses. So now everything is expanded. So these are the first properties that were created. And then this addresses array or list, it contains two objects with these properties. And as a result, everything can be navigated to. So so far, we have learned how to extract data by just naming a property. But if you need to extract the name of the city for one of the addresses where that person lives, for instance, or has a property at, then how do you go about doing this? So let's focus on this. We'll take care of that task, and then we will go back to see how we can simplify this logic because it looks a little bit too clunky. So now in the person object, there is a property called addresses. And if we were to do this get property block and then specify person and specify addresses, guess what this block will return? If you guessed that it will return a list, you are absolutely correct, because whenever we go into the person object and we retrieve whatever the addresses property has, it has a list, and therefore whatever the value is will be returned by this block. If we were to specify here name property, then this block would return a string. But since we are going after the addresses property, it will return a list. So now, since it returned a list and we want to get, let's say, first item from that list, how do we do that? Well, if we go into lists and then use this block right here, all right, then we can get first item. In fact, let's put that first item in here, number one. But then this list right now, it's identified by this variable, which we don't need. What is going to be that list? Well, it's the whatever is returned by this get property. So if we put it in here, then this will return the first item from our addresses list. It's going to be this object right here. And now that we have that object, we can actually get specific property, okay? And in order to get that specific property from the object, what are we going to do? If you guess that we have to go to objects and do the get property again, you're absolutely correct. So the property that we'll be getting is, let's say, city, and then we'll be getting city from the object that needs to go here. Where do we get this object? Right from this guy. Put it in here. So now we have this logic, this codeless logic, that will retrieve the city from the first object in a list of addresses. Let's review it one more time. So in here, we take the person object and we get the property addresses. All right, so that returns a list. Then we got that list, and then using this block right here, we get the first element from that list. And then the first element from that list is going to be the object that contains the specific address with these properties. So we have that object, and now we use this block, and we pass that object in there, and we say, okay, in that object, get the city property. All right. So now if we were to print out what this block returns, we should be getting Dallas. Let's run it. And as you can see, we got Dallas. By the way, if we were to go and change this to number 2, so we're getting the second element from that list, guess what this will print? If you guessed that it will print New York City, you are absolutely correct, because now we got the addresses list, and we got the second element from the list, and then from that second element, it being an object, we got the city property and printed it out. Let's do it again. And see, we got New York City. Okay, so this is a good example of kind of navigating the object structure. So now that we have gotten to the point where we can retrieve that city, before we will move forward, I'd like to simplify this logic a little bit, because it's just, there's a lot of stuff going on. And what I'd like to do is to shift this process of building that list into a function, okay? And that function will be just sitting separately, just like I have a couple of functions here that are leftovers from other previous lessons. So I will create a new function, and that function will be called addCityToList, okay? And then the parameters for that function will be, let me just change the scale a little bit. It will be, we will have city name, it will have state, and it will also have street address. All right. So now inside of this function, we will be creating that object, and we need to add that object to the addresses list, right? So we can actually pass another parameter, which we'll call list, okay? So in order to add a city to a list with all the data being passed in, this function will be performing exactly the same thing as this block. So let's copy that block and put it in here, and just change a couple of variables. Okay, so the list that we will use is going to be the actual list. We will be passing it as an argument. Here, the street address are not going to be any of these values. In fact, we will be using the parameters of that function. So these parameters are street address, goes here, and then city, we have city name, goes in here, and then the state variables, state will go in here. All right. Now, what I just noticed is that when I picked the function, I actually picked the one that has a return connector, and that's not the one that I wanted. So let's just rework this a little bit. So we will take this function, move this out here. We will call this one add city to list. See it. Added number 2 just because this one already exists. We can get rid of this and rename this to add city to list, and then declare all our variables again. Made a little mistake of just picking wrong block, but we can quickly fix that. So we will have street address, we'll have city name, there's going to be state, and there's going to be a list. That's it. It is now ready to go. So the function is ready, and let's start using this function. And to do that, here's our addCityToList, and then we just need to pass all the right parameters to it, like this, and the actual list, and that's going to be address. So this can be deleted, and then let's replicate it one more time, and specify the right variables. This can go away. Moving them out here, or just retyping the values. So this can be removed. By the way, to make it more compact, if you right click and say inline inputs, then that becomes more compact. So now we have a custom function that just adds an object with all the data that we're passing into it, and then adds this object to the list that we're passing in. Notice that the list is going to be our addresses. So we're sending addresses list into the function. The function does something useful. It creates an object, adds it to the list, and then it's done. So that list will be updated. Okay, so now we have a little bit more compact version of this logic. Let's move on. And the rest of this will work exactly the same because nothing has changed structurally about this list. We can actually run this page to make sure that it still works. So see, we still get this New York City printed out from the second item. So the next thing that I would like to do is to modify that person object where it has a property that points to another object. So far, it has a property that points to a collection of objects, addresses. But let's say that this person has another property that is called employer. And an employer will be a object that contains some other properties about the employer. So for this, let's do the following. We will set property in person. Let's make a copy of this. I'm going to make it a little bit larger for you. All right. And then the property will be called employer. And then the value will be a new object that has some other properties. So it could be name, it could be phone number, and it could be, for instance, URL or website. All right, now let's add some values to our employer. And then the company name, for instance, it is Backendless. The phone number, can actually use our number. And then the website will be the URL. In fact, let me do the HTTPS, backendless.com. All right, so now the person object has additional property called employer. Let's print out person and see what it looks like. All right, so here's our person. Now it has addresses, and here's the employer. And as you can see, employer is essentially just one level. There is one additional level of data that is in person. So the question is, how do we get a hold of specific properties that are sitting inside of the employer when we have person object? It is going to be exactly the same process as we followed by going inside of the list. And then for this, so I added the print block. If we go and get the get property, and then we get the property, for instance, employer first, employer. And then the employer will be obtained from person. So what do you think this will return? This returns the complete object, this one specifically, and that object has all the other properties. So what if we, and what we can do is we can go inside of that object and get its own properties. So that means that if we take another one of these, and then this one will be the object from which we're retrieving data. And then now, if we put website, this will actually get the website property from the employer object. Again, let's read the whole thing. And generally, you read logic in Codeless from right to left. So starting from here, we get the property employer from person. That gives us an object because the employer property references an object. And then for that object, then we retrieve the website property. So basically got an object and then inside of it, we get that property. Let's run it. And as you can see, we got the URL of the of Bob's employer. And this way, regardless of how deep the hierarchy is, you can just continue going down that hierarchy, actually going up because it's right to left, to retrieve the actual values. It may seem kind of complex, but in reality, it's a fairly simple process of just navigating that structure. That's all I have for you in this lecture. Thank you for watching this video, and as always, happy Codeless coding.